That is such a powerful, powerful song. It's very moving every time I sing it with you guys. And it reminds me just how much God understands each of us, and yet, even if that's the case, the fact that he's aware of everything that we've done, everything that's going on in our lives, he still loves us. And for me to grasp that, and as we sing that, wrap my mind around that, I honestly am overwhelmed at the end of that song. And maybe there's some of us in the room who, like myself, sometimes wonder, am I really worthy of that kind of love from that kind of a being? And yet I understand that it runs even deeper than we can ever imagine. And he's called us into that love relationship in a way that despite our shortcomings, his grace overshadows where we lack. And it is on that premise that we're doing this message series on God is on a mission. And the question may be in your mind as you come this morning, well, what is God's mission? What is he wanting to do? And how does it have anything to do with myself? And maybe it helps to understand a little bit the mind of God as we go into it and just how critical it is for him to connect with us. That maybe I'll explain it this way, perhaps from my own point of view. Back whenever I was just a budding teenager, my parents and I, in our home, we had what was called a rotary phone. Have you guys ever seen a rotary phone? You want to call somebody, you got to take all 7 digits. Back then, you could at least get away with 7, but sometimes you had to mix in an extra 3 and make it a whole 10. And so you would take your finger and you would just spool it around each number, and it would go back. And 5 minutes later, you would finally make that connection with the person. So a long time. And whenever I was a kid, my parents were trying to get me comfortable with using the phone in ways that would be constructive. And so for example, we used to race motorcycles, and if there was something that I needed to find out about or something that we needed to do relative to our equipment, my dad would say, I want you to make the phone call. And I'd be like, okay, but I'm just going to come across as a complete and total idiot. But I'll call. And I can remember going through that whole succession and just overthinking, all right, when I talk to these people, I've got to sound like I know what I'm talking about. And oftentimes I came across, I know, like some kid who didn't know what he was talking about. And it made me very self-conscious. And then one day in junior high, there was a girl, her name was Fran, and she slipped me a piece of paper and she said, why don't you give me a call? And I was blown away. I'm like, holy cow. I knew that, you know, she seemed kind of interested, but the fact that she gave me this number and now I got to call her, what do I say? And I remember going home and just looking at that number for a very long time. And then I finally got the courage up to dial the number. And this is back and forth. There were a couple of times in the process I just stopped and I hung up because I was psyching myself out thinking, what if she says no? What if she rejects me? What if I come across sounding like a complete idiot like I know I've done in the past with people? And you're just overwhelmed with all of this second guessing, and a lot of it has to do with the fact that you feel like you might be rejected. And yet, when God calls us, he knows that there's a possibility that we will reject him as well. But he is so confident about everything that he has to offer you and I that he's more than willing to face any rejection, even rejection on a cross, to get across to you and I the point that he is deeply in love with us. And he wants to do everything that he is within his power, apart from just basically overriding our free will to love him back. He wants to do everything to show us that that's really where his heart is at with you and I. And when I think about that, I'm just blown away because I know what it's like to be rejected, and I know what it's like to get my words mixed up. I know what it's like to be misunderstood. And yet God says, I do too. And it's worth it to make that extra effort. And so now between this day and Easter, we're going to look at how God is on a mission to connect with you and I, perhaps in a way that he's never connected before. And maybe you're thinking as you come in here, I know that I want God in my life. I know that God wants to be a part of my life, but oftentimes I feel like it is hard for me to make that connection with him. And hopefully in the course of these weeks, we can get that sorted out. And so today I just want to look at a brief passage of scripture. It's in Matthew chapter 4, verse 18. And if you have a Bible, please take a look at it. I encourage you to do that every once in a while, where we just go blank on the screen, because I think it's important for you to understand that one of the most critical ways that we connect with God is through his word. And there's a Bible in front of you in the pew, or if you like, just listen. And in the passage of scripture I want to share, it basically says this: as Jesus was walking beside the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon called Peter, and his brother Andrew, and they were casting a net into the lake, for they were fishermen. Come follow me, Jesus said, and I will send you out to fish for people. And at once they left their nets and they followed him. Now, as you read that story, you find that it's the first of many stories that are offered in the New Testament that describe how Jesus interacted with different people that he saw along the way, that he invited to be a part of the wonderful enterprise that he was called to do. And that was the mission that the Father had given him to fulfill in his life here on earth, and then to expand on that into your life and to mine. God is on a mission, and it's on a mission to reconnect with people who are disconnected from him. And there are a lot of reasons why we disconnect from God. Some of them have to do with just an unwillingness to have anything to do with him in certain decision-making parts of our lives. And the other part may be that we have been turned off by people who said they've represented God to us, and we don't want any part of it. And sometimes it's just the fact that our filter inside of our head is so jacked up that we can't really tune into him like we need to. And in all of those cases, God is saying, I want to help you. I want to help you get clarity on the type of connection that we need to have with each other. And when Jesus was walking down the pathway along the Sea of Galilee, and he saw these two brothers, he looked at them. And when he did, there was a sense of just current. It was like they understood him, he understood them in an instant. Because there's not a lot of backstory to this passage. He goes up to him, and there is just something about the way he carries himself that when he broaches the question, follow me, they just drop everything and they say, we're with you. Now, that may sound a little bit like that's just fairy tale land, but as we get into the message, maybe you'll understand why they were so ready to take everything that they were doing in their life up to that moment and just drop it, and then in a spirit of surrender, offer their lives to him. And I know that as we come into this place, there is a desire for all of us in some way to bring God into our lives. But the problem is we may have to undo some things or redo some things in order to connect with him in the most healthy way possible. So what I'd like for you to do is, this is a little bit of an interactive sermon. I'm going to map something out for you this morning. And what I'd like for you to do on the back of your bulletin, if you have a pen and you want to play along, please just draw a circle. And in that circle, make it big enough to where you can have four corners of that circle. Even though circles don't have corners, this one is gonna. Okay, because these are actually the four corners of the world. And people travel all over the world. They go to the mountains of the Himalayas. They go to monasteries all over Europe. They go on pilgrimages in South America because they're looking for God. And other people, they're looking for God, but they don't go to all of those places in order to find him. And the bottom line is, there is a place where you are at physically, and of course, it's right here, right now, but there is also a place where the you inside of the you is at. Let me just give you an example. My children, both in college, about once a week we'll have a conversation with them, and invariably the conversation is, where are you at? And a lot of it has to do with just what frame of mind are they in? Are they in a good frame of mind? Are they feeling good about themselves or situation? Do they need encouragement? I'm not asking, where are you at right now? Are you in your dorm? Are you in your are you in your workshop at your school? Are you in the bridge, the eating place? I never bothered to do that. Partly because their mother has that stalking feature on the phone, you know, where you find them. So if I need to know where they're at, I kind of got an idea. But I really am more interested in where are they at? Because I think that's the question that God has in store for all of us. And where you're at is going to make all the difference in the world regarding your connection with God. Now, there is also wired within each of us a feature that is indicative of this device right here. If you've ever flown on an airplane, you'll notice that one of the first things you're instructed to do at a certain point is to turn it off. And you turn it off, and you fly around, and you're like, I can't wait to turn my phone back on. Or you're thinking, I'm glad I got away from my phone for a while. Whatever the case may be, chances are, whenever you hit the ground, and I'm guessing that probably the men are guilty of doing this. Before the flight attendant says, okay, now you can unbuckle your seatbelt and you can turn on your cell phones, probably a lot of guys have already got their cell phones turned on and they're looking. And they see a little thing at the top saying, searching, 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 because it's looking to connect, because these things really aren't of great value unless you connect. You can play a few games on them, but that's about it. They need to be connected. And if they're not, they're going to let you know, I'm searching and searching. I will drain your battery until I find that connection because I'm so desperate for it. And maybe in another part of the airplane, there's a little baby. And that little baby at some point probably did this, just broke out in ear-piercing cries over and over and over again. And if you've ever been around infants, you know how this works. Now, chances are in a plane, it's pretty fixed. But what that baby is doing is looking for a connection with someone who can offer comfort in their state of distress. And they're going to keep crying until a capable or loving or the person that's bonded with them connects with them and gives them a sense of assurance that everything is going to be okay. And God is, in like manner, looking at you and I. And he's integrated into us a chip that says searching, searching, searching. And the thing that we're looking for at the end of the day is God. And God is on a mission to locate where we are at in our headspace, and then his desire is to connect with us in the process. Well, there are probably only four possible networks in the four corners of the world that we connect with God through. And this connection that the disciples had with Jesus when he said, follow me, is found amongst these four. But sometimes, whenever we are looking to connect, there is no connection. And that would be the disconnection corner. That's the corner where, when we go there, it doesn't mean that there aren't any people around us. It just means that practically all the people around us are not connected to us where we're at in our spiritual or mental headspace. We're there, they're there, but we're not connected in any meaningful way, other than perhaps we're just doing things in the same space, and somehow through biology and maybe a few other ways, we have some kind of a connection. But the fact is, we're still in that state of searching. And maybe the connectedness that we're looking for is right in front of us, but for whatever reason, we remain disconnected. Well, there was a There was a study done by NPR, or that was shared by NPR not too long ago, and it described what's going on in this connection process relative to the stresses that occur whenever we are not connected, whenever we are searching, burning up all of our energy, trying to find that connection, only to never find it, only to find ourselves stressed to a point of depletion. And they just looked at it from the angle of stress, and they did this. These psychologists got together, and it seems like the most interesting tests that psychologists do often involve electricity. Now, why that is, I don't know, but it makes me question the profession just a little bit. But this particular test was trying to gauge what it was that elevated a person's stress relative to being shocked, and what it was that would minimize or reduce a person's stress relative to being shocked. So just bear with me for a minute. Whoever they found to be the people that would subject themselves to this, my hat's off to them, and I wonder why sometimes. However, whenever they get the candidate in place, they would say, okay, now in about 10 seconds, we're gonna shock you. One, two, zzz, and they would shock them. And their stress level, because of all the little things that they had mapping out their brain activity, would just shoot through the roof. They said, okay, now we got a baseline. We would like to go to the next step in this next phase in this process. And we would like to take a person and have them hold your hand, and as they do, we're going to shock you. So they said, as they set it all up, 10 seconds into it, 1, 2, 3, 10, shock them. And they looked at all the indicators, and even though another person was holding their hand, the stress level was almost unchangeable from the previous phase. And then they said, okay, this is what we'd like to do now. We would like to take a person in your world that you're connected to, that you love and respect, and they love you, and they're a meaningful part of your world. And we'd like to have them come and join you for this experiment. So however you talk that person into it, I don't know. But when you do, and they sit down with you, they're to hold your hand. And when we shock you, here's what's going to happen. We're going to get a bead on how effective it is on your stress level to have someone like that in this particular stressful equation, and we're gonna find out what the readings say. And did you know that when that experiment concluded, that third phase indicated that when you're holding the hand of someone that you know and love and respect, there's almost no measure of stress in that experiment. Now, how weird is that? But I think it underscores an important point here. And we're going to circle around to what happened in the situation with Jesus and the disciples. But the point is this: God has given us this capacity to long for connection. And oftentimes the stress in our lives is an indication that the connections in our lives are not what they need to be with the individuals that go to make up our lives. And so sometimes we just disconnect. Now, the thing I think is interesting about these two guys is that they have vocationally taken themselves out of what's happening in civil discourse, in the community, in the city square, in the relationships. They're fishermen. If you've ever gone fishing, the one beautiful thing about fishing is this: it's quiet. And there aren't that many people, if any. And all that you have is yourself and maybe a fishing buddy and a very placid looking body of water in front of you. And it generates so much peace. There are some of us who've been in those occasions where we go through phases where we can't get enough of that, because we love the state that it puts us in, and we just enjoy the fact that we can be removed from all the chaos of life and the relational dysfunctionality and those things that go to create stress and elevate it to degrees sometimes that are unmanageable. And so I get the broad appeal of being fishermen. chances are these guys understood how the world worked. They were living in a land that had Roman soldiers at every point, basically watching their every move, exploiting them, making them carry their baggage, saying insulting and condescending and racial epithets, you know what I'm saying, that thing, and basically elevating their stress every time they saw them. Notwithstanding the fact that if they wanted to connect with God, they had plenty of religious leaders who paraded themselves around the countryside in a way that they were scanning for converts, only to give you a list, a regimented list of requirements that you would have to basically honor and effectively submit to, in order for God to become a part of your world, in order to connect with God. And so the stress was pretty great, notwithstanding just the basic stresses of ordinary life with people that are part of your family. So I honestly don't blame these guys for being fishermen. But I also think these guys were still searching. These are two brothers. And when they see what they're looking for, they drop everything. They had been living in the disconnected part of the universe, and it was awesome, but it wasn't enough. It wasn't enough to check out. And there's another corner of the universe, or the world rather, that I think you have to consider. And that's the corner of the bad connection. And you could just put that on number two here. Bad connection. That's a corner that we go to try to connect. And it doesn't always mean that when we try to call, we're getting static, but it generally means we try to call and it is crystal clear. But the things that we're hearing in that conversation are what make it a bad connection. Because the relational connection is fraught with all kinds of dissonance and dysfunctionality, stress, and things where the two people that are trying to connect are going in different directions. And this problem is of such a nature that it expresses itself in this way. It means that at the end of the conversation, I end up feeling bad about myself in some way. Or I find that there's nothing that I can do to please this person. Or I just don't feel good enough after I have this conversation. Or I can't meet up to their expectations, and every time I talk to them, we're just talking past each other. And sometimes the connection is of such a nature that it's not even with other people, but it's just with that voice in your head that's just reaffirming everything negative that other people have said to you over the course of time, causing you to second guess yourself and have misgivings about your relationship, even with yourself. And when God sent his son into the world, the one thing that he understood clearly about the people that he would be talking to, the way that he addressed it was, I not only want to save them, but I want to save them together. So that together, as a community of people, there would be health vertically and there would be health horizontally. And that's the thing I love about Jesus, is that he, when he comes close, he just goes right to the center of our problem in ways that I don't think anybody else can even begin to execute. And this is what happens a lot of times in our lives whenever we have the bad connection. Let me just spell this out a little bit. There are two forces at work from a bad connection. One is, it makes us feel out of control. Maybe because it's not going the way it should, and we'd like for it to go the way it should. Or maybe they're heaping stuff on us in a way that makes us feel like we're not in control because they are controlling me. And so that forces a bad connection. And unlike the people who decided to go by the sea and just check out for a while, there are others who tried to engage. And so they thought, I'm just going to control my circumstances. And alongside them, there are other people who in those bad connections experience the force of, when I'm with other people, I feel like I'm having to please them all the time. And I feel so controlled either way. And I feel so judged. And We respond to that. Our bodies respond to that. And there's a part of us that says, I don't want that. And there are some people that are called to follow Jesus that actually live in those environments and have figured out how to control them and to control their connection with other people. And this is probably best demonstrated by a guy who is called just the rich young ruler. He was a guy who went up to Jesus and he said, okay, I understand just intuitively, you're different than the other guys. And you are saying stuff that resonates with our whole tradition. And so why don't you tell me, because I need to lock this down, because I have to have it all locked down anyway. Tell me, what is it that I need to do to inherit the kingdom? Because, you know, I know that loving God with all my heart and loving my neighbors myself, that's what I'm supposed to do. And Jesus understood that what was in play here wasn't getting the right answer, but it was how much he wanted to surrender to his God connection. And so this particular person, we're told in Scripture, when Jesus said, go and sell all of your possessions, the first thing that he did was he looked at him. And he had that connection with them. And it was obvious that Jesus understood his heart. And he said, as he looked at him, Jesus felt a love for him. And so he offered this. One thing you lack, go and sell all you possess to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. And then come follow me. But at these words, he was saddened. And he went away grieving, for he was one who owned much property. And we read that in Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 27. Why is that? Because he liked his connection with God, even though it was a bad connection, because at least he controlled it. And the thing I know about God is, it's kind of an all or nothing thing. He tells us to surrender everything in order that we will be fit to receive everything that he has to offer. Did you catch that? He tells us that we have to surrender everything that we're clinging to. Because if we're clinging to it, it's a way of saying we're controlling this part of our lives and we cannot let it go. And maybe there are things in your life that you say, God, I want you in my life, but I only want you this far because I want to control this part of my life. I want you at this part of my life. And God says, it doesn't work that way. That's a bad connection. And then there are some who say, I'm ready to relinquish that control. But there's another connection that happens. And it can short circuit the process as well. It is the third corner, and that is the feel-good connection. And this is a good one. I mean, everybody loves to feel good, right? But it can't sustain us in any meaningful way. You know, there is a chip inside of us searching. And if you're like me, at the end of a work day, you come home, and you're pretty depleted. And perhaps you just don't have a lot of bandwidth left, or you're just tired of all the challenges and you're looking for something to say, I just want to feel good for a little bit. And that's when we can get in trouble with our connection. And the connection can be like this. I'm doing everything that I can as a parent, as a husband, as a wife, to provide for my family. I'm doing everything that I can to do a good job in the workplace. I'm doing everything that I can to be charitable. I'm doing everything that I can to invest in my kids. And if you are like me, you at the end of the day, you just feel depleted. You know these are good things, and you love to do these things, but you also know that they take it out of you. And so in that state, sometimes we can forget about that connection again. And this is what happens. We start to say, I need a feel-good connection. And we can move into the realm of self-medication. We can just find you know, the role of alcohol playing a place at this point in our day, or we can find some other form of self-medication that at least gets us through that, but is disruptive to the connection. We can look for distractions that say, okay, I just got to find something to unwind with, and in so doing, disrupt the connection. We can get involved in internet porn, which is a very powerful way of disengaging. Or you can be like the one Christian woman who ended up having a love affair with two guys at the same time named Ben and Jerry. And as she was engaging in that pursuit of fine ice cream, she was just indulging herself in the riches of the pleasure of the senses of the palate. I have a confession. I did that last night. My wife made brownies, and I smelled them, and I'm like, I don't eat a lot of sweets, but for some reason, they were just saying, come here. And I'm like, oh, no, I can't. But I had to go upstairs and get something. I was down in the basement, and there they were. And they were, well, two people can't eat that whole thing, so they needed help. And so I took a big slice of it, put it in the bowl with some, not Ben and Jerry's, so it was good, it was legal, and had some ice cream. Went downstairs, ate it. Oh, it was so delicious. Immediately, I thought, I got to go back upstairs and use the restroom. Went up there. Oh, there's more to eat. So I grabbed some more. I ate some more. I went downstairs. After I got done, I know a preacher shouldn't say this, but I felt like crap because it was like my sugar buzz just came and went. And this morning I tried to pry myself out of bed, and I'm like, I still feel nasty from eating all that junk I ate last night. Had nightmares and all that stuff. I just swore it off. Till next time. But that's the feel-good connection. And the Bible says, sin will offer you pleasure, but only for a little while. And then pretty much, there's nothing left except a soul that is saying, my soul's not feeling too good right now, and my connection with God, it could show some improvement. Well, in all of these cases, it's just a way of looking at the calling that Jesus has put on us, saying, follow me, and understanding what that calling means. You see, these guys, when they were by the Sea of Galilee and they were looking, they were searching, they were longing for something that would help them to connect with God in a meaningful way so that they could have some peace with the whole question. And when God showed up one day, it was just surrender on the spot, because he's clearly the real deal. And that leads us to the third corner of the earth that we can go to find our network connection with God. And it is this. It is the real connection. And the real connection, interestingly enough, the very first real connection happened not with Jesus singling out one guy and saying, I want you to follow me, but rather, Jesus singled out two guys, and he said, hey, you two, follow me. And the two guys looked at each other, then they looked at Jesus, and they set everything down. They surrendered all, and arm in arm, they went with him. Because here's what I believe about God and connecting with God. And it's not from me, but it's from the resources that a lot of us have been doing as we've been working on small groups. And that is, the best way that we can grow spiritually in our connection with God is to connect with other people relationally. Because the interesting little fact about following Jesus is when we surrender all, it basically is saying, oh, you know what? Don't drink and don't chew and don't go out with girls who do, but rather do this. Surrender all so that space that is inside of where you are, I can fill with myself. And then I can flow through your life relationally to others. And I am here because someone honored that And they allowed God to flow through their lives so that through their lives, I could connect with God relationally. As I was connecting to them, I was connecting with Him. Isn't that awesome? Jesus said, I'm going to make you fishers of men. But these guys are like, we're fishermen, Jesus. We checked out from society. We don't want to go there. But Jesus said, it's not based on the natural ability that you have, but rather the willingness that you have to surrender everything to me and the desire that you have to allow my presence to flow through your life. And when you do that, you'll do stuff that you never thought you could do. And your religion won't just be one slice of a very complicated set of experiences that you've set up in your life. But rather, your religion won't be that at all. It'll just be a life-giving relationship based on a solid connection with a Savior who's done everything that He possibly can to ensure that you understand how important you are in this equation. And like those guys there, and like so many people that are described in the Bible, Jesus is saying right now, follow me.